Well, it's with great pleasure that we're here today for the annual UNI Football Media Day. A lot of friendly faces here. Nice to have a bunch of you here. Certainly appreciate your coverage throughout the year and going forward. Well, we're here today for head coach Mark Farley's press conference. Just a couple of numbers to consider with Coach Farley. Right down there, it's Sheriff Field. And Stan Sheriff captured 129 wins here over his 23 years as a head coach. Coach Farley is at 120 right now. So 9 wins away from tying Stan Sheriff. And certainly this season, Coach Farley's averaged over 8 wins a year. 9 wins is certainly not out of the question. So we could certainly have a very historic football season this year. Looking forward to some new coaches as well. Coach Farley will go over that. At least 5 new on the staff, a new offensive coordinator, a defensive backfield that would rival some FBS defensive backfields. Coach will go into that. But before further ado, head coach Mark Farley entering his 15th season at Northern Iowa.
Okay, so welcome. Glad you're all here, and don't even need mics, do I? All right. So I guess what I'd like to address this one probably is I'm going to open up the questions much sooner. I don't want to go through everything. You guys get the information that you need, and I'll go in depth in anything you want. And as you know, as you ask me questions, it kind of opens me up to other things. So instead of me rambling, I can kind of give you a quick synopsis, and then you guys take it over and get what you need, and then get access to those guys that you need downstairs. The big thing is this. It's kind of like this picture that we just take. Never assume anything right now, okay? We've got a whole new coaching staff, meaning we've got 5 new guys. We go out to practice. You think you got everything written in detail to the letter of your practice, the minutes, where to be, when to be there for 24/7 for basically a month. And then you're ready to go to practice, and the first question you get asked is, where's the practice field? So you can't assume anything that there's some guys that don't know the basics, that where to be, when to be there. And then ultimately, the big thing is how do we do things here at UNI? Because I think you have to be very unique here to be successful at UNI, because it's unique and a great place. But you have to understand the University of Northern Iowa. So in that regard, that's what we're trying to teach, not only the new players, but to our new staff members. And it's gone very well to this point. We are in currently, we just had our 10th practice, we're going into our 11th practice. So usually this press conference is much earlier, but I believe we had to see what we had before I started talking about it. So I've got a little bit better idea what we have now and going from there. So with that, I'll expand on any questions you got and we'll go from there. So I'll open it up to you guys.
Coach, could you talk about your linebackers and specifically how's Barkley developing?
Okay, linebacker-wise, I'll go right to Barkley first. Barkley from Cedar Falls High School, we moved him from running back to linebacker. Because of the depth we had at running back and because of the need that we had at linebacker, I felt that it was a better chance and a better opportunity for him to move into that linebacker position. We did that in the spring. He was very successful in the spring, and that's when you experiment with him, so we left him there for this fall. The only thing is, you know, he's had some knee problems, you know, that's been aggravated, and it got aggravated in the spring, and it can get aggravated if you go 2-a-days will aggravate it because of so much use. So we have to balance that with his progression of first-time playing linebacker and progressing him through the knee so that we can get him healthy to the season. He's doing very well, and he's the second-team linebacker right now, and mainly it's because of knowledge and experience is why he's there. Other linebackers working within that group right now, I think that's a position that needs a lot of critique and a lot of competition, because I don't know who the starters will be. I think Brett McMakin is by far the guy that kind of leads the role as far as talent on the football field. You know, he's got experience, he's very talented, and he's going in his third season. He's got everything we need. He's got the height, he's got the speed, he's got the toughness that you need at linebacker. So Brett McMakin is one of those guys that we'll have to count on at that position. Jared Farley, I like what he's doing right now. He's at the mic and the wheel. He could play either position for us based off who the other linebacker is. And then we've got Blake Wilson, Duncan Furch, young man from Dallas Center. Duncan was a running back when we recruited him. We now have him at linebacker. He actually is doing a great job at linebacker as well, and it's the first time he's played for us. So between Blake Wilson, Duncan Furch, and D'Angelo Jennings. D'Angelo Jennings was a junior college guy, that is now going into his senior year. You haven't heard a lot about him, but he's at the stage now. He understands how we do things and what to do. And D'Angelo could be the mic backer for us, Jared the Will, or Blake Wilson the Will, Jared the Mike, wherever Blake Hill ends up being. Barkley, how it all fits, we'll start moving it around to get the best three or four on the field that we can. And that's kind of the makeup of that linebacker group.
Coach, you mentioned that you were happy with the depth that running back has made with Barkley and linebacker. Let's go to the running back side. With the end of the David Johnson era, is it more sharing the load, or do you feel you have a guy that could carry the load like David did?
Well, you're not going to replace David. I mean, we all know you. He was a great running back and a great, he was a great teammate. You know, he did so many things for us in special teams as well as in the locker room and as a running back, but we all know him as running back. So to be direct to your question, we have right now, I believe, three candidates that can take that weight and carry it as a group. I'll start with Tyvus Smith. Tyvus out of Davenport he was actually mentored by David. Tyvus is a great story. I mean, if you want to look into what background and how he got here and how what he's done since he's been here, he's a great story because he took the path of David, he was mentored by David, and he took the course of David after he saw the success. So to David's credit, he was a great teacher too. And that in that regard, that's where he was ready bringing Tyvus along, character-wise, social-wise, athletic-wise. And I think to Tyvus's credit, he followed that lead. So Tyvus knows who to follow, and that's what you got to do to be a great player too. So Tyvus Smith is one of them, and he's got great size. You'll see that when you get on the field. Two others that we felt that we had to secure to make sure we had experience as well as talent at that running back. Savon Huggins came out of Rutgers. He was here in the spring, of course. And Savon, it was an exceptional back in high school, exceptional for Rutgers, and he has been a great leader. And he's got great cuts. I mean, you can see he makes a decision. He goes. He's got a vertical push to him. So he's a very good runner for us. And then Darian Miller. Darian Miller, of course, we've had now. He's going into his senior season, and he's quick. He's got that great quickness. He's got that speed. So how we use those three, I think those three are definitely three guys that I would say are in the top 11. You know, and I always look for who your top 11 offensive players are. Now, how do I get them all on the field with one football? So there's a lot of those things going on when we establish who the players are, but I'd go with that. And then behind that, you got Javion Browning. And Javion he's come to his point in his career, redshirt sophomore, that he's ready to play because he was a great running back. It's now how he fits in that mix as well. So I don't want to leave him out, but those three, I think, have established themselves as the front runners for that position.
Well, Coach, you talked about the changes in coaches. Obviously, build back on offense, mm-hmm. but those 30 years of coaches on the offensive side of football, will that change your philosophy or how you go about business?
Yeah, I don't know if it changed the philosophy. I know you better wake up in the morning and have your motor running because, you know, it's fun to see guys, anytime you're somewhere new for the first time, there's a lot of energy within that. And being that they're here, they have a lot more energy because they know what this place is known for and what we are. So they're excited just because I think they know a little bit about the past because this is their first media day. They don't know what's going on. As just as well as practice 11, they don't know what's going on. But they're excited because they know what this place needs to be and what it expects to be. And they came in here to take us to that level and to take us to another level. So, yeah, have I changed philosophy? No. Have I changed some plays? Yes. And have we changed some ways we're doing things? Yes. But I also will say this. If we're going to be good and good and sustain being great, and I just want to sustain being great every day, whatever that is, then I think you have to have a common foundation. And I think that's what we can carry through. I think Bill brings that. He knows what this place is about because he's lived it. He's gone to school here. He understands it. And if we can establish that in our new coaches, it'll take them time to figure that all out and then them being the mentors to our players. But what I love about our new coaches is the men that they are and the leadership and the mentorship is probably a better word for that, the mentorship they give our players. Because we're not only about football, you know, we're trying to be these guys' mentors while they're here about how to be good and great and how to prepare in everything they do, not just in football. And that's when I looked at these guys. What I look for, I'll tell you what I look for when I, going through all this hiring process, you learn a lot. And we've hired a few. I think the number one thing that I look for is a person I trust, a person that I can be, that I can get to trust. And they have to be a great teacher. So when I get them on a board, I want to make sure they can get in a room and the players will respond to the teaching. And if that, I sit in the room and I interview him, I say, man, if I'm sitting in the room and I'm a linebacker, will he inspire me to keep me alert in this meeting? And can he teach me how to get to where I belong? And can he motivate me? If I can get that in basically out 30 minutes, I think I got a sense of that. Then I need to see him on the field. I need to see how they react and respond to our players on the field. Can you be a grass coach? Can you get out there and show them how to do as much as tell them how to do it? Because I view myself as I go back when I was a player, what did I need to learn? And I think every individual needs to be taught a little bit differently and be able to connect with their coach. And I really believe we hit a home run with these coaches because it took a long time. I didn't hire the last one until I think he got here on Sunday and we went to practice on Wednesday, something like that. No, he got here on Monday and we went to practice on Wednesday. So it turned that fast because, you know, I hate to settle for anything. Not at UNI. We want to be the best, or we'll wait to get the right person here. And I think we waited, and through that patience, I think we've got a great coaching staff, because what I've seen in the first 10 practices is exactly what I'd hoped I'd seen, is great teachers that are mentoring and as well as motivating.
How comfortable are you with the no huddle, especially being a former linebacker yourself?
Well, we've been, you know, the no huddle thing, I get a little bit of kick out of it because we've been no huddle. We've been practicing no huddle for 5 years. Now, have we done it in a game? Yes and no. But when we did it, it was no big deal. It's been around. We've been playing against it since we played New Hampshire in 2005. The first time we ever played the no huddle was when Chip Kelly was the New Hampshire offensive coordinator, and that's the first time I was introduced to the no huddle offense. And then since then, the Texas State, we played Texas State. Well, that's Herman, who's down in, he was the offensive coordinator, now the Houston coach. So we were introduced in an abrupt way back in 2005. Now through all the years, we've developed our defense as much as that, and now I think we've played enough against it that we can put our ideas defensively to tell our offense what really hurts a defense in a no huddle. And it's not just coming to the ball and playing games. It's how to use your formations in the field, what really hurts the defense. So I think the combination of what we know and then what Joe brought to the table, I hope we can make it really strong with what we come out as the UNI version.
What have you seen out of the quarterbacks, Coach? And is anybody emerging as kind of the guy to lead this new offense under Joe Davis?
There's the quarterback, if you go to stretch this afternoon, it's the longest line. I mean, we got more red jersey. I think I can make a whole kickoff team out of them. They're all over the place. But I know this, being here as well, is you got to have a quarterback. And if I can help, I'll never go into a season without enough quarterbacks, because it's like tailbacks. You can't have enough of them, I don't think, because of injuries, because of the game, and because they touch the ball every down. So to answer your question directly, I'd say that there are four primary guys in the hunt. The four primary guys in the hunt right now, Sawyer Cole Morgan is, of course, the one with the experience and the one that's been here with us that's done a great job. And these are in no order. You got Sawyer Cole Morgan. You have Eli Dunn. Eli Dunn was the freshman quarterback we took out of Grinnell. Eli is having an exceptional two-day camp. He had a great spring, second half. Early on, he was okay, but the second half, he was exceptional, and we all remember his spring game. He left off. He came back to where he left off. He's very confident. He's got a great arm. He's got great size. Eli is sitting in there. Then you have Dalton Demos. Dalton was here in the spring. And Dalton is a junior college player from Hutch, but Dalton has great size and can really throw. I say, watch the spin of his ball. When the ball comes out of his hand, man, it's got rotation to it. He's got a great arm, and he's got great athleticism. He came off that ACL last year, did a great job all summer, so he has the athletic ability that maybe others don't have, that burst of speed, and he can really spin it, and then he's got the size as well. So he's got the total package going for him. And then the last one is Aaron Bailey. Aaron Bailey came here and got here. He was here all summer. And Aaron Bailey, you'll see, has real good thickness to him, real good size to him. He's got real good speed to him, and he can throw the football. So, you know, it's. I think there's enough to pick from. They're all different, and you know what they are? They're all smart, too. And it's neat to see how they're competing because they're working. All have had equal reps to date. We're just rolling four. I don't care what team they run with, first team, second team, third team. Doesn't matter to me. I just want to see how they operate. With the intent being, do you still look good with the third team as you do with the first team? Because my belief a quarterback is you need to make the other 10 guys better. You can have great talent. But unless those guys trust you, unless they believe in you, and unless you match their talent, then I don't think you can be a great quarterback on game day. So I'm looking for who can make the other 10 better as I'm watching them on the field, how they operate with the third team as much as how they operate with the first team. And the bonus of that has been for us is I think it's made our third team guys better because we're going to need them too because they have progressed like a first teamer would just because of the environment they're surrounded by. So I should have been doing that for a long time, but because it's brought the other 10 along. So I'm very pleased with that progress, but we're going to have to make a decision and cut somebody's reps and start moving somebody forward here. It's time to move. So today, there's four. Look at our depth chart, there's four across the line. But there's going to come a time real quick that we got to start making a depth chart so one guy gets more reps with the ones than the twos because we got to get ready for a football game.
Mark, based on the preseason rankings, is this one of the toughest schedules you've ever faced?
It's not easy, but, you know, nothing much is, you know, anymore. So instead of looking at it in that regard, because, yeah, when you're early in the summer, you look at that schedule, it's a grind. But exactly what I told our football team here, it's this. You know what? They are so lucky. They're probably the most fortunate football team at UNI for this reason. They get to take on this schedule, number one, number two, number six, Big 12, and three of those four on the road. And if you make it through and win this league, then you have done something no other team on those walls have ever done. You won it with the toughest pass ever to win it. You had to win it with a new staff. You had to win it on the road, and you had to win it with what's in front. You have more opportunities than any team on those walls have ever had, and you can separate yourself from all those teams if you can pull those things together, and if you can do the things you need to do to win games, then you'll have something that no other team has ever had, and that's doing it with the newness of it all as much as the schedule and the opportunity being tough. I think it's a great opportunity, and that's the way I want those guys to view it, and that's the way we're attacking this thing.
How appreciative are you in line with Delaney said about Big Ten and wanting to move away from it? How appreciative of you getting to play in Iowa State? Do you see those games becoming less occurring, maybe? Is that a movement or is that just a Big Ten thing?
What I would say to that question is this. I think I said the first press conference I ever did in 2001 as much as this one umpteen years later. We, and I know I personally, but we appreciate you and I, Iowa State and Iowa, playing Northern Iowa in football. I guarantee it, okay? I respect the heck out of those two programs, okay? And I think the fan base of those two, you know, when you're not going to those two games and when those games are over, you're either one or the other. But all Iowa and Iowa State fans can beat Northern Iowa fans. So I'm very appreciative that those athletic directors and football coaches in particular will play us because they don't have to. I get it. So they play us for a lot of right reasons. So doing so, to finalize that, I think the FCS, BCS playing one double A's, there is a need. There's no question we need it. But I think also to balance football, it needs to be done as a whole for college football. And I say that for this reason. We're all about the opportunities of the student athletes, not the opportunity for TV. And the opportunity for the student athlete is for to be able to compete in every situation and give that person, it's an opportunity for us to play at Kinnick Stadium, to play at Iowa State. And it's an opportunity for those players to experience that, and yet it's an opportunity for them to progress into a season, because we're always worried about safety of players, to progress into a season instead of be thrown into a season. You look at basketball, December is really irrelevant because nothing happens until January because those first four games, warm-up games for the most part. So football doesn't have that opportunity. We have to come out of the gate fast and hard, but yet we're worried about the safety of the players. So I think there's an element there that you have to has to be stressed instead of just worrying about how much money is on the table if we're really looking at the safety of our players. So in all regards, we can all say what's good for us and spin words on it. I would hope that everybody would continue to want to play Northern Iowa. And the coolest thing, I think at Jack's Trice Stadium, that if you look in their book, that the UNI Iowa State football game is the number one and the number two and the number three right now. And if they just built a new stadium, I'm guessing by the end of the game will be the number four. So that game will be the number one, number two, and number three all-time largest crowds at Jack's Trice Stadium, which I think is pretty cool, not only for Iowa State and Northern Iowa, but for the state of Iowa and the what they want to see at football games. So it's other people's choices, but that's my stand.
Well, Coach, one of the reasons why you've been able to compete at Kinnick and also Jack Trice is because we'll be measured up on the line offensive and defensive lines. How do you stack up this year going to Jack Trice?
We're going to find out. You know, I'm dead serious about this one. Man, you're going to see what I see. You don't think I don't know what, I don't know what's going on this afternoon, okay? I know it's scheduled, but how it unfolds, I'm not sure. And that's what we have to manage as we go through it. And that's been the fun part for me, because this is different for me, because you see much more, because I'm looking for much more. So when we hit that field for the first time, you know, the offense has four new coaches on it and Coach Solomon. So, you know, we're going to have to guide those guys through it to what is going to experience it, because we want to put our best foot forward and we don't want to do something that will hinder our chances of winning by something we control. And thus, I got to make sure we go through game day atmosphere, communication, all those types of things, because we don't want to find out on the run, you know, doing it. So that's where we have to do a better job. So really seriously, as this thing unfolds, there's going to be something that comes up that we didn't expect. Now, how do we adjust as a new group? Never been through it before. We can plan for it, but we'll never know until it actually happens to see how we execute in it. That's the key. So, yeah, can we? You know what I'll always say, we can go anywhere, anytime, and we'll compete at Northern Iowa. But I also, as the head coach, are saying, man, we're going to have to really execute to be able to do that. And the execution will be the key, and how we respond to those things that are new to us is what we need to practice, and then how we adapt will determine if we win.
Coach, what was the last time that you had this much turnover, both on the player personnel and coaching personnel? Or has it ever been this much change?
No, I said it was like 2001. I went to the deal down in Des Moines last night, and this is like 2001. We inherited that coaching staff at that time, and I think I got here in April, and that was Bill and I as well. And so now through all this, it's a little bit different, but it's like doing that all over again, where you really try to look to the strength of the guys that you're surrounding yourself with, whether it's a player or coach, and you try to go with their strength and not fight it. You know, don't make them do what we do. I want them to do what their strength is within the UNI way. So yeah, it's like 2001, and I've relied on that protocol as much as anything as I went through this, to try to coach up the coaches as much as coach up the players, but yet let them play to their strength and let them be who they are.
Your calling card has always been defense, and you kind of lost the heart of your defense, both in Jake and in Xavier. So how do you replace both their production collectively and their leadership on defense?
That's probably been the bigger test than even on offense right now, is just as you explained it. Jake was more vocal and knowledgeable. You know, we've got younger guys there now, so it's not their nature right now to be that person. So we have to find another way to communicate that. So there might have to be some more control from the sideline than what there maybe had been last year. So we'll have to play to that as this unfolds. But that's exactly how you try to handle it. Same way, you know, in the secondary. I think our secondary is solid. We still got to get on the football field and perform. And I think DeAndre Hall, Mackin, and Dorleant bring a lot to the table, and Kilfoy. I mean, when you start talking names, that's a strong group. Kilfoy's a strong safety, leadership ability, that type of thing. DeAndre Hall is exceptional athlete, exceptional communicator, great personality. Mackinton is in his third year starting, so we've got three guys that are three-year starters in the secondary, and now it's to find that free safety. And we've got right now, we've got a lot of guys rolling through there. Jordan Webb is a fourth-year senior, so he's got experience. He just hasn't been on the field for us. DJ Singleton, he transferred in here out of Nebraska. He's working that spot. We've put Edwin Young in there, a backup corner who could be safety. Again, just trying to get the best players on the field. And then there's one more in there. I mean, I'm rolling that free safety to figure out who that is so that we can build the other ones and slide them into the other positions, because I feel real good about the depth at corner as much as the whole secondary. So I'm kind of leaning on the secondary as we develop the linebackers and the defensive front when we get on those guys, because they have to really – don't make any linebacker look like an All-American if you got a good defensive front. And the front is Adam Reth. You know, he's worth your time. Adam Reth is – man, he's about as hard of work as you'll find. He is Iowa. He is you and I. You can put it stamping on a tattoo, man. He is everything we want in a football player at you and I. Isaac Alice, he is you and I football. Okay? Those two alone are you and I football. If they walk on the field, when you go down there, that's you and I football to me. They may not talk a lot, but go watch the football game. They work a lot. And they work and they succeed. So those guys are you and I football. Griffin Greta is going to get a huge chance this year. Wyatt Pfeiffer is going to get a huge chance this year because he's a fourth-year senior. So we have that workmanship, that UNI football attitude in that front, and that's led by UNI football Bryce Pop. So again, you want to do it the UNI way, recruit those kind of guys attitude-wise, cut Coach Pop loose with them, and then he's going to develop that talent, and then thus, hopefully, we can cover up the linebackers till they figure out what they're doing.
Stay with me. Losing guys like Mack and Xavier, I mean, how tough is that going to be to plug in, you know, like a guy like Xavier who's really, you know, that's a player that's really hard to find? What kind of changes could you expect if the tackle is not going to be plugging the hole as much, or the lack of size? Or what would you say?
Well, that's going to be tough because he was a force. I mean, he was a flat force. You watch going down that stretch. If the one guy that was tearing up the middle and dividing the offense in half, it was Xavier. And that's all we want to do with a player like him is divide the field in half. And now I don't know if we have that guy. So if we don't have that guy, how are we going to do it? We're trying to develop him as we're going. I think there's guys that can do that. I'm 19 days away from figuring that one out. But we did pick up a young man by the name of Bryce Douglas. You'll see him walking around down there. He's kind of a Xavier-sized guy. He's not Xavier Williams, but he's got 3 years left to play, so we're trying to develop that. For this season, Adam Reth, Isaac Alice, those are the types of players. Ezra Zerbeck is going to get his chance. If you put him in a room and took the face off him and just ran bodies at you, they're all the same player. They're just your football player that's going to be a vertical push guy that's their motor never stops, and they're just as good on the first down as they are on the 50th down. I mean, they're just that kind of person. Doesn't matter who's wearing the head, is that jersey is going to be coming at you, whether it's the first down or the 80th down. And if we can do that and roll guys like we did last year, then I think we've got a chance to be what we were last year. You know, but you're not replacing Mack or Xavier. Those guys were fourth, fifth year seniors that played in the way you know, they were the same temperament, but now they're experienced players and they're that much older, that much stronger. We just got to get there a little bit faster. So great question, but those are the things we're really looking at on defense.
Coach, you lose three of your top receivers from last season through spreading out 10 practices in the fall. Who do you see kind of emerge at that spot looking for more?
At the receiver position, that's another one. And what happened is, at the receiver corps, we had the three of what I felt were very good receivers, LeMaster, Vereen, and Owens, and they played a lot. Problem is they were hurt a lot. So last year, none of them were ever really healthy, and even Vereen played with an ACL last year because he tore it in the summer, and thus he got it fixed right after the season was over. So he really wasn't himself all last season, but yet was very productive in a way. So this year, that was a focus of attention. And how do we get that core back up to where it was? And we ended up that Darius Fountain, I think, is a great player. He's only a sophomore here, and we played him a little bit last year as a true freshman. DeReese has size and speed and talent and will be a great player here. He is a great player right now, and he's only got years ahead of him to come. So I think DeReese is the lead person in that group. Other guys that we're working with hard that have to be guys for us this year. Right now we have we ended up at the we got Logan Cunningham, who has a lot of reps for us. He's got to step to the forefront. Marcus Weimiller had a great spring. He's got to step to the forefront. I think the other Z position, we've got Charles Brown, okay, has got speed, and he's been on the field for us a lot. So DeReese, Charles, Cunningham, and Weimiller, I would say, are the experienced players for two or three of the spots on the football field. The other ones we brought into the mix now is we picked up Jarvis Holly from a junior college. He's a junior college quarterback who has great speed. And we picked up Rod Hall, who is the Clemson point guard that has 1 year of eligibility left. He started 3 years for them in basketball, played four, and yet you still get your redshirt year in football. So he actually has 1 year left in football, and he chose to continue, so he's out there as well. So we tried to bring some experienced guys in to help with Jarvis and Rod, and yet we have the four or five that we already had here playing receiver. So we have to find that mix and match and get the right guys on the field.
Coach, now that you have some time to work with, we'll see you go with the offense. What strikes you about Joe
Davis? He's got a motor. He brings the motor to the field, which creates the energy within the players as well. So how he attacks practice is how he runs his offense. And that's different than what we've done before. So that's the difference, I would say, in our offense is what's happening at practice. That's what's happening on game day, what's happening at practice. And thus, I think we'll relate to a little bit what should happen on the field. Did that answer your question? Somewhat. Fire away. I'm still good.
Does he have to make any adjustments coming to this level of football, or is he pretty well prepared with God?
No, we studied him. I studied him quite a bit stat-wise. Even all the way back to when he was Division III at Wheaton. You know, I wanted to see if his team's progressed while he was there. It wasn't just coming in and be good once. I think we all can be good once. Can you do it and sustain it, keep going when everybody's after you? And he's walking in a place that this is a defensive league. And when I looked at his stats from years past, whether it was at Shippensburg or at Wheaton, when he took over an offense at a program, it progressed through the time that it was here. It was good. It was better the second year than it was the first year. And it was better the third year than it was the second year. So when I saw the progression in comparison to the other people within his league, equal talent, equal stats, he had progression and he was on the top end of the top 15, top 20 in most categories progressively as he went through it. I think what we owe to not only Joe, but I had to surround him with the right people. And I think Ben Barkema, who's coaching our offensive line, okay. Ben Barkham was a home run. He's an Iowa guy. He's from Muscatine. He knows what an Iowa player is because he is one of them, and he knows that's the type of person we have to have in that offensive line to win. So I think he brings that element to that room. Tight end coach-wise, when we hired Nick Danielson, he's a spread offensive guy. He was trained and groomed by Christensen, who is the offensive coordinator for Texas A&M, and his background is essentially an offensive line coach. So I wanted two offensive line coaches, and yet he's our tight ends tackles, but I felt we needed two offensive line coaches that ran spread to be able to do a great job. So we got one that's got the Iowa foundation and one that's got the spread slash wide open to give that element to the room so they all can communicate in same ways and bring ideas to the table. Not only, it's not Joe, to me it's our offense. And thus I got guys that can support him and give him ideas from, you know, Nick came from Utah. And he was at Wyoming for that. And then we got Jason Ray coaching our receivers. Jason Ray played at Missouri, captain of the Missouri football team, which is spread, very detailed. I always look at who coached him, who trained him. And I know Pinkel runs a very disciplined, detailed, everything is by the book, by the number, everything is detailed. Then he went on and went to Wyoming with Christensen, who I know as well. And thus from there, he ends up going to Oklahoma State. And then he comes here. So he's been in the spread at Missouri, Wyoming, and Oklahoma State. So he can sit in that room and bring ideas to the room from a BCS mindset and not just what Joe is. So it's not, don't tag these guys with where their division they are. That'd be like tagging us. You better tag them as who they are and as a unit, what they'll become is what I'm looking forward to. And that's why we try to create that room as it is. So yeah, it'll be interesting because they have their ideas where they come from, and I thought it matched what he did and a little bit countered what he did, so we can put the U and I version on the football field when we play Iowa State.
Mark, with so many unknowns, offense and defense, how big of a benefit does they have an experienced special team?
Well, it's really, you know, you say that, I didn't even think about it until you sat there and just told me. It's real easy to go out and say PAT field goal, and you're not worried about it to the point that maybe I should practice it this afternoon, because when I don't worry about stuff, I don't emphasize it. But I am comfortable that we have a great kicker, that we have a great snapper, and we have a great punter. And our PAT field goal is, our holder is our punter. So we're out there for 2.5-3 hours, and all you have doing is Trent Simpson snapped on Logan Bigler, kicked by Schmadtke. So yeah, that rhythm is there, and that'll get there in time because that's all they do. So it's finding the backups to those guys, because Trent took a concussion at the Illinois State game, last game of the season, because they, you know, he's running down the field trying to cover, and he got sideswiped. And then you got, you know, those guys might get hurt. You might lose a punter because of a blocked kick or something like that. Who's the next guy? Because if it falls off too far, it's going to cost you a football game. So I'm looking at the next guy's coming up to make sure they're ready. Should their turn come, it's going to be the heat of the battle with the game on the line. Will they make that play? I'm not so concerned about the ones that are out there, because I know they're prepared from experience as well as what they do every day.
Speaking of injuries, how's the health so far in spring?
We've been blessed as far as injuries. We have guys down, but they're not. I think in the depth chart, it hasn't affected much of that. We've had to make some adjustments, but all injuries are, you know, 2 and 3 day injuries. They're not 2-week, 4-week injuries right now. So we've been blessed that way and been very fortunate to date. But our physicality has to get tuned up here. We can't get this offense ready, nor our defense with the players you're talking about, unless we get really physical. And that'll be the fine line. We're going to have to get, first I wanted to find who they are. Now the physicality has to come up. So between now and next Friday, that may or may not change, but we do have to pick that part of our game up in practice, and we got to be smart about it.
But how is it that you guys are able to find kickers, you know, Schmadtke taking all the receivers and Schmadtke just kicked like you got to eat if he wasn't missing a beat? How is it that you guys are able, especially the, you know, these guys are local guys right here, these part of the state?
You know, I've thought that so much, and I can't believe that's not a story, but I'm glad you asked. For this reason, you know, how do we find them? I don't know that we find them. I think if you would look at UNI football, and even UNI, here's what I think UNI is, and here's why I think the kickers were there. It's parallel. They come here, and they got to make themselves. They come here not expecting to be, hey, I walked in the door, and I'm great. I've got the full scholarship, and I'm here, and I'll just get better because I'm here. They come in here thinking that, just like we all have to do, we got to go to work every day because we're not good enough. But yet we know we can, but if we just work at it, we're not worried about the outside world. We're just going to do it our way, and we'll be ready when our time comes. We're confident in ourselves, even though everybody else put the tag on us. And I tell you what, and then you put our kickers over in the corner. We don't have a kicking coach. We don't have a punting coach. And I don't have a snapping coach. I never have. We got guys that direct it and manage it, but our kickers coach our kickers. Right now, Schmadtke is coaching Easley, and in turn, Easley will coach the next one. Logan is teaching Cooter. Cooter is teaching the next one. So it goes all the way back to 2001 when it was Homebrecker, and then who was the punter that went to the Redskins? Pardon me?
Bernard.
Well, Bernard. Bernard was taught by the guy before him. When I first got here, he played in the league for a while. I can't remember his name. Frost. You said it, Frost. Derek Frost. Okay? So, well, I tell you all that because of this. You got players coaching players. You got players that know how it's done here. And they take the time to teach their competition every trick of the trade they can, and they pass kind of the baton down to the next guy. And just like in all of our business, you try to groom the next guy so he can take over instead of just grabbing a guy from outside your company and sticking him in there. and then they love you and I, and they work for you and I, man, when they kick, it means something to them. So, yeah, am I comfortable when I send a kicker out in the field, and if he misses a field goal? I sleep that night because I know at least he was prepared. I understand you might make a miss, but if you're prepared, man, I'm good with it. I can sleep that night. Now, if I stick a guy out there that just because he can kick at 100 yards, and I gave him a helmet, and he's a four-star, and he doesn't know how to do it, and doesn't really believe in you and I, then I've cheated our football team. And I know Schmadtke and Bigler will not cheat our football team because they're going to put the work in, whether I'm there or not, whether I'm looking or not. And that's the way it's been all the time. So hopefully if we can sustain that, then I think we'll always have great kickers.
Now, Sawyer Colbert, newcomer of the year as a freshman. He's done great things, Camp Randall, Ken Aiken, Jack Trice. The fact that he's still competing right now for the quarterback job, does that send a message to the team that you can't take anything for granted?
I think it's, I don't know if it sends a message. What I want to think of you and I is that we develop players here. Whether you're the senior or whether you're the junior or the freshman, you know, you came here to play. Once you get the job, you still have to develop yourself day in and day out. If we're going to be great, we want a redshirt senior playing that's been developed over 5 years. If we bring a guy in, we're still bringing in and develop him, but also to create the competition to bring your level of play up. It's not fair to Sawyer if I don't bring another guy in. Because if I don't bring another guy in, you kind of become complacent. We cannot become complacent here. When he brought up BCS and Jim Delaney, I want the Missouri Valley Conference, Jim Delaney, to know that the Big Ten and the MVC are equal in our heads. It's either all or nothing to me. It's either you are or you aren't. And thus, just like in your question, you either are or you aren't. You can develop yourself that to that level. So, yeah, Sawyer Cole Morgan, there's competition. To his credit and to the man that he is, we've brought a lot of quarterbacks in here while he's been here. And I think it's made him better, but yet it maybe hasn't worked out as pure as it could have for him. But at the end of the day, it's made him a better person because guess what? You guys deal in it every day. Competition is out there, and it's going to be in every phase of your life. So be prepared and prepare yourself. So that's what we're trying to do.
Any message for the fans, Coach?
Yeah. It's right now, I think they know who we are, but I would be excited if I were them just to see what's going to happen. I'm excited just to see what's going to happen. You know, it might be good. It might not be good for a boy, but I'm still excited about the fact of what could happen. And that kind of raises the bar because we've been defensively, I think we've ran four different defenses here in the 11 seasons or how many years I've been here. I don't even know. But out of all the years I've been here, I know we've run about three or four different defenses. And what I try to do within that is get the best defense that fits the offenses that are being played today, not just in the MVC, but on the East Coast and the West Coast, because we want to be the best in our division. So I'm trying to look at what's going on out there and try to stay 2 years ahead of it. This is the first time on offense that we'll really tweak our offense. We've probably been in two different offenses since I've been here. This will be the third one. So we've been on four different defenses, it'll be the third different offense. So we take the good. So what's cool about this is this will bring this offense up to speed, which is more what you would call modernized, but it still has to fit you and I. Just because you're running gun doesn't mean it's good. You and I, we're still Midwest, our players are Midwest, so how do I fit the best scheme to fit the talent that we can recruit? And that'll be the key, is this the system, and we have to tweak this system to fit our version of it, which is our players, which is who we can recruit day in and day out, because this isn't a one-year thing to me. This is who we are in years to come, and then we'll change as football changes. So, yeah, look forward to it. Stay in your seats. We'll see what happens. We good? All right, thank you.